These are just four of many, many, many prophecies in the Old Testament that foreshadow the coming of the birth of Jesus. It was told for generations and generations, these stories, these prophecies, all leading up to what we find in Luke 2, starting in verse 1. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was the governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went to the town of Nazareth in Galilee, to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house of the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who he was pledged to be married to. Was pledged to be married to him, and they were expecting a child. While there was there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them. And the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you the good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of heavenly hosts appeared to them with the angels, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see what has been promised to us and what the Lord has told us." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in a manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. All who had heard were amazed at what the shepherds had told them, but Mary treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they were told. On the eighth day, when it was come time for him to be circumcised, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he was conceived. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for Christmas time. Thank you for everything that is involved in this season. Father, use me as a mouthpiece today. Let your words move forward about your story, about the most important story of all time. Jesus, move in this place. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. In Jesus' name, amen. So the world was getting rough again. A lot of you know the story of Noah. The world got so bad that Noah was commissioned by God to build an ark because the world needed to kind of have a reboot. But once again, the world was getting rough. Righteousness was depleting. The government was corrupt. Religion was ran by religious leaders that were tainted. Humanity was once again headed down a dark path. And it was time for the prophecies to finally be fulfilled. It was time for the world to get the Savior that they had heard about for generation and generation and generation. And a lot of you know that I'm a big superhero fan, so when I think of something needs to be saved, someone better put a mask on and a cape and go out there with a bow and arrow and save him. But that's not what the world needed. The world didn't need the medieval knight, the knight in shining armor, the king on a big, huge throne. They might have thought that's what they needed. But what they really needed was something that nothing could explain other than a miracle of God. They needed a baby. Not just any baby coming any normal way. A baby that was born of a virgin. This baby was sent not only to save the world, but to become the blueprint of love. What love really looks like. The blueprint of how we need to live. And the roadmap of how we can be saved from what will only lead to destruction. He is, as Pastor Dave talked about yesterday, the only plan. When we're battling with something, when we are battling against ourselves, He is the plan for us to be saved from ourselves. And this is a lot like it is today. Back then, the world was going into a dark place and people were in a dark spot. Kind of feels like today. I've never seen a more corrupt time. I've never heard of a more corrupt time than now, whether it's government, whether it's even churches. I drove past a church in Birmingham that, controversial or not, had rainbow flags everywhere. I truly believe in loving everybody, but I don't believe in condoning that sin. And that's where we're going. We're going to a place where our world is just okay with sin and glorifying sin, whether it's at home, at our workplaces, in the world, or just even in the church. We seem to always fall back into that hole that at one point God cleaned us out of. That could even be our spiritual lives, right? We get on these spiritual highs. A lot of you who grew up in youth group, you go on these youth retreats and it's like the best experience ever. For those of you who have gone to kids camp, you come home and man, God is another level. God is up here. Everything is great. You come home, you're reading your Bible, you're excited, you're listening to worship. And a few months later, things start to taper off again. The world starts to creep back in. But 2,000 years ago, a baby was born so that no matter what pitfalls we have, no matter how bad the world gets, because the world was pretty bad back then and he saved it. Lucky for us, we serve a God who is alive, who is constantly, constantly saving us over and over and over again. Lives are still being changed. People are still lost that are becoming found. And the Christmas miracle is still life-altering today. The beautiful part of this miracle is that when Jesus came, it didn't overcomplicate things. It didn't make things tougher. If you remember the Old Testament, when people would try to get saved or try to find God or try to experience the Spirit, God, they wanted to understand more, there was like 5,000 steps that had to go into it. You had to walk through this, you had to do this, you had to pay this, you had to sacrifice this, you had to go into a room with something wrapped around your leg because chances are once you experience the glory of God, you were going to die because you weren't perfect and they'd have to pull you out. It was complicated. Just to see God was complicated. Not anymore. Jesus came as a baby to grow up to a grown man, perfect in every single way, to then die on a cross for our sins. And I know a lot of you know this. Every face in this room I've seen before, you get this, you know this. But sometimes we forget the simplicity of what God came to do. With the complicated nature that it was before he came here, Jesus came to die so that we would have access to the Holy Spirit. We would have access directly to God. James 4 talks about it beautifully. Starting in verse 7, it says, "Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up." It's kind of a darker scripture, but at the same time, we've all been at that point. I don't think any of us got saved because life was so awesome all the time and we were always happy and everything was good and we never made a mistake. No, we found a point in our lives where we go, God, if not you, I'm done. I'm toast. The Message version says it pretty awesome. It says, "So God, let God work his will in you. Yell a loud no to the devil and watch him scamper. Say a quiet yes to God and he will be there in no time. Quit dabbling in sin. Purify your inner life. Quit playing the field. Hit bottom. Cry your eyes out. The fun and games are over. Get serious. Really serious. Get down on your knees before the master because it's the only way you'll get on your feet." Friends, Jesus being born is so much more than just a story. It's the reason we can live with no fear of tomorrow. It's the reason we can live a life fulfilled. It's the reason we can wake up every day and know that there's purpose. when before we met Jesus, life was not that. You didn't know what was coming tomorrow. If you died, you didn't know what to expect for you or your family. You woke up every day kind of wondering what's left. There's got to be something more. Christmas is about a baby who was born in the most simplistic of ways, in a manger, only to grow to change the world in the most radical of ways. Maybe you're here today, and though you've been through the church motions many, many, many times, you've gone through the prayers, you've gone through the worship services, you've gone through Sunday mornings, you've gone through Bible studies, but you've never truly made that point to go, you know what? God, I am really far away from you. I need to commit my life to you. Or maybe you're here today and you've ran from God. And this story is a refresher of, oh my goodness, how wonderful he is. How far I've run, but how simple it is to come back. Because I'll tell you something. You can never run too far from God. There's no distance, there's no action, there's nothing you can do in your life that will separate you from what God has planned for you if you come back to him. God is waiting open arms. If the band wants to come back up. God is alive and well. He sent this son, a baby, not just for the Christmas story, not just for a good time, not just for a miracle to show that he is God. He sent his son to become fully human so that he could be the ultimate sacrifice so that we, unworthy people, people that don't deserve it by any means, can have life, can live a life fulfilled. This Christmas season, as we celebrate with our families and our loved ones, as we celebrate with meals, opening presents, let us take a step back and remember that without Christ, without what he did, without him coming and being born, dying on a cross for us, without him, we'd be in a world of hurt if we tried to live on our own. Let us remember that God is out there and he loves us so much that he is alive and well. He is still working. That he is willing to do any sacrifice, even if it's his son. And let us not forget the most important announcement, the most important news, as we saw in that video. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Now I'm going to pray here, and if you are one of those people that maybe you've never accepted Jesus in your life, or maybe you just need that refresher, I'm going to pray with you. We have two more songs. As soon as I say amen, if I handed you a lighter earlier, we're going to start lighting those candles, and then we're going to worship. So dear Heavenly Father, I thank you. Lord, I pray if there is anyone in this room right now and they can come into agreements with me, Father God, that they are lost, that there is only one way to living a life fulfilled, to living a life of purpose, to living a life where we know that we don't have to fear tomorrow. Lord, your word says, fear not 365 times in the Bible, one for every day. So we can rest assured knowing that no matter what your plan is, no matter what comes against us, no matter what is in front of us, God, that you have the ultimate say, that you are in control, that on this Christmas season, we are so blessed to know that you sent your son to be born in a manger, to live a life of perfection, and then to die the most brutal, sacrificial death of all time, so that we may have life. As we celebrate Christmas, Lord, I pray that if there's anyone in here that is far from you, that all they have to do is humble themselves and just call out your name. James 4 makes it very clear. Whisper his name and he will be there in a hurry. If we can humble ourselves, Father, you will show up. So, Father, I thank you. I thank you that lives are changed. I thank you that the Christmas season is still alive, that people are still singing your carols, Father, that people are still celebrating your name in December all over the world. Father, I pray that today is just a catalyst for 2020. As we move into the new year, Father, let today be a reminder of our mission, of what we need to do, Father, that we need to be constantly spreading your word, your love, your joy, Father. That there is a world out there that needs you as their Savior. As we celebrate Christmas, Father, let us not forget, as cliche as it sounds, the reason for the season, and that's you. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.